In this problem, we have two objects. One of them, M2, is hanging from a rope. The rope is connected over a pulley, and it's connected to another mass, M1, which is going to be sliding along a frictionless horizontal surface. And so as M2 is released, it starts to fall down, and it's going to pull M1 and cause M1 to accelerate to the right. And in this problem, we're going to go through and we're going to calculate the acceleration of each of the blocks. And we're also going to calculate the tension in the cord connecting the two objects. To do this, there are a couple of methods. The method that I'm going to use is going to be one that's, for some people, possibly a little bit longer, but I think it's a better method as you're first starting to learn how to do these problems. It's a little bit easier to understand. Also, when you get into more complicated situations, this method will continue to work. You won't need to change this method. And so this is a very good way to get started at doing these problems. And so with this, we know that M2 is going to fall downward. It's going to accelerate downward. And M1 is going to accelerate to the right. And as I go to set this up, I'm going to let the direction that each block accelerates be the positive direction as I look at all the vectors. And for each of these objects, I'm going to look at all of the forces that are acting on the object. And I'm going to use this to come up with relationships between the tension in the cord and the acceleration of the objects. So in mass one, I have the tension in the cord that's pulling it to the right. I have the force of gravity acting on mass one. But because it's sitting on a table, it's not moving through the table, it's not moving up and down perpendicular to the table pushes up with a normal force that's going to balance out the weight of M1. And so as I go to do these problems, the first thing that I do is I draw each box individually. So I have mass M1, which was 12 kilograms. And again, there were three forces acting on M1. There was the tension pulling it to the right. There was the force of gravity. And for this box, it's 12 times 9.8, or 117.6 newtons. But again, I'm not really going to need to worry about that because the normal force acting on this box is also 117.6 newtons. The normal force is canceling out the force of gravity on this box. And so for box one, the net force on box one is just the tension. I need to add all of the individual forces together, and the normal force and the force of gravity cancel. The only thing that's left is the tension in the cord. But Newton's second law also gives us a relationship between the net force, the mass, and the acceleration. It says that the net force on an object equals its mass times its acceleration. It tells us how big the acceleration is with a certain net force. So the net force that's acting on this 12 kilogram box is its mass, 12 kilograms, times the acceleration that it has. Again, this box is accelerating to the right. So putting those two things together, I have that the tension in the cord equals 12 kilograms times A. And just to make things a little bit easier, I'm going to leave off the units for all of these numbers. So I have two unknowns. I have the tension and the acceleration. And if there are two unknowns, we're going to need two equations. And I'm going to get my second equation from looking at M2. On M2, we have the force of gravity acting on it, pulling down, and we have the tension in the cord pulling up. So again, I draw the individual objects. M2 is 2 kilograms. The force of gravity pulling on it is 2 times 9.8, or 19.6 newtons. And I have the tension in the rope pulling up. Here's one of the key ideas. Because this accelerates down, I'm going to set this up so that down is the positive direction. Because if I go back and I look at this situation, Mass 1 accelerates to the right with an acceleration a. Mass 2 accelerates down with the exact same acceleration a. As long as this cord does not stretch, those two blocks are the same distance apart. That means that their position is changing at the same rate. That means that they always have the same speed. That means that their velocity is always changing at the same rate, which means that they have the same acceleration. Because they're connected by a cord that's not going to stretch, and it's not going to compress, it's not going to go slack, those two objects have the exact same size acceleration. So to make things easier, we want to let that acceleration A be a positive number for each one. And so I'm setting it up so that the acceleration is positive for each object. So when I go back and I look at the net force on mass 2, I need to add the individual forces together. I need to pay attention to my positive and negative directions. Because I'm saying that down is the positive direction for mass 2, that means that that force of gravity, that 19.6 newtons, is in the positive direction, and the tension T is in the negative direction. So when I add my individual forces together, I have positive 19.6 newtons plus negative T. And again, Newton's second law tells me that the net force on mass 2 is its mass, 2 kilograms, times the unknown acceleration A. So if I put those two things together, I have that 19.6 minus T equals 2A. So now I have two equations. One relating the tension and the acceleration. A second one relating the tension and the acceleration. So I have two equations and two unknowns. And so now I can use substitution to go through and try and solve this. I can take this tension, since the tension is 12A, and I can substitute it in right here for T. So I solve one equation for one variable in terms of the other one. With this one, I didn't have to do much. I already had one equation that said that T equaled 12A. Otherwise, I'd have to go through and I'd have to solve for one variable before I could substitute it in. So I solve for one variable in terms of the other variable, and then I substitute it in. So I have 19.6 minus T, but T is 12A, and that equals 2A. Or I have that 14A equals 19.6, or A equals 19.6 divided by 14, which is 1.4 meters per second squared. And so the acceleration of each of the blocks is 1.4 meters per second squared. Mass 1 accelerates to the right at 1.4 meters per second squared. Mass 2 accelerates down at 1.4 meters per second squared. And then to calculate the tension in the cord, I just need to substitute that acceleration back in. I have T in terms of A. I have that the tension is 12A. So the tension is 12, again that was 12 kilograms, times 1.4 meters per second squared, I get that the tension is 16.8 newtons. And now let's pause for a second and go back and double check things. If I go back and I look at the situation, because M2 accelerates down, then the downward force of gravity, which was 19.6 newtons, has to be bigger than the upward force of the rope, which was 16.8 newtons. And so this agrees, if the tension is less than the weight of the object, M2 will accelerate downward. If we would have made a mistake and we got something that had the tension was bigger, that wouldn't match up with what we were saying. We would know that there's a problem. Also, going back and looking at this, some people might say, well, why didn't I plug the, how did I know to plug the acceleration into the equation that said t equals 12a instead of the equation that said that 19.6 minus t equals 2a. You can plug the acceleration back into either one of the equations that relates the tension and the acceleration. It was easier to plug it into the one that had t by itself, but if I plugged it into the other one, I'd have 19.6 minus t equaled 2 times 1.4. And so if I'd solve for t, I would get the same thing. I would have t is 19.6 minus 2.8, which gives me 16.8 newtons. Again, if they don't work out to be exactly the same, that may happen if you have an acceleration that's rounded slightly, if any of your numbers are rounded off, but they should work out to be exactly the same. The tension in this massless cord going over a massless frictionless pulley, the tension is the same on either end. In more advanced problems later on, sometimes you start looking at the mass of the pulley and you have to worry about things. That's one of the reasons to look at this problem using this method, because in those more complicated problems where you have to worry about the rotation of the pulley, you need to set things up in this way using the several equations with several unknowns, and that's the only way that you'll be able to solve those problems. Again, with these problems, the final thing to do is always to go back and double check, see if things make sense. The falling object is accelerating with something that's less than free fall, so we get something that's less than 9.8 meters per second squared for its acceleration. And again, because we knew that that falling object was accelerating downward, we knew that the tension was less than the weight of that falling object. Again, double checking those things will help catch some common mistakes that you can make, and it's always good to keep those conceptual ideas in mind at the end of the problem.